Okay, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Let me make sure I'm on the right slide. Yes, okay. So hello and welcome to the 2021 NCWIT Virtual Summit on Women in IT, which continues to be the world's largest annual convening of change leaders focused on significantly improving diversity and equity in computing. My name is Brittany Anderson Martin, and I am the NCWIT Workforce Alliance and Regional Initiatives Project Manager. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our final event of this series, our Conversation of Change, Conversations for Change series that have been happening this past week for our summit. Our Conversations for Change series feature speakers with a diverse range of perspectives and hopefully provocative ideas and worldviews. Throughout this series, we've shared a video showcasing the outstanding work of our 2021 NCWIT Collegiate Audience Collegiate Award recipients. So today's video will highlight awardees at the graduate level. Please join us in recognizing and honoring these awardees and more at the virtual 2021 NCWIT Collegiate Awards Showcase that will be happening on June 3rd. So please enjoy this video.
Hi, my name is Farida Tasneem. My project concerns the development of a skin-like sensor that allows you to communicate messages using muscle movements. When laminated like a sticker on the face, it allows people with neuromuscular disorders such as ALS to communicate. This project stands out because its design was informed by quantitative analysis of strain data from the face of individuals with and without ALS. This allowed for accurate decoding of subtle facial gestures while reducing data bandwidth in bits per second to three orders of magnitude lower than the industry standard. As I'm rounding off my master's in biomedical engineering at MIT, I'm switching gears in my PhD to study the physics of complex systems to help us better understand general principles about how living systems arise and function.
My name is Angelique Taylor. The goal of my project is to enable robots to deliver supplies to healthcare workers as they treat patients. However, patients are often situated in hallways, which is a great safety concern because robots have the potential to interrupt patient treatment. To address this challenge, I designed a system that enables robots to observe a patient treatment and predict how acute the patient's condition is. Then the system uses this information to avoid areas of critical patients. In the future, I validate my system on a mobile robot in a medical training center. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Hannah Pasandi, and I'd like to take a moment to say thanks to the NCWIT Collegiate Award Committee for recognizing my work on a learning-based framework for self-driving design of networking protocols. This project aims to replace the current human-based protocol design with a learning-based framework that is able to learn how to adapt the networking design protocols based on the network condition, application requirements, and the user objectives. And I really hope to see this in practice. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Isabel Petrola, and my project is TLDR, Extreme Summarization of Scientific Documents, in which we built a model that automatically generates TLDRs of scientific papers. TLDRs are short, single-sentence summaries that communicate the main points of a paper, and they can be easily incorporated into a scientist's workflow to help them more quickly decide which papers to read. I'm currently pursuing my PhD at Johns Hopkins University, after which I hope to be a professor in computer science.
My name is Estrat Kasim Jaradat, and I'm a PhD student at the University of Texas at Arlington. During the last year, I've been working on Cherry, which is a system that detects and corrects cherry picking. Cherry is a state-of-the-art machine learning tool that is trained to pick up selection bias in text and then generate an alternative unbiased text. In the future, I hope to continue studying automatic methods to combat disinformation as a computer scientist.
My name is Lexi Rangioni, and the title of my project is High-Resolution Quantitative 3D Imaging of Blood Vessels and Bone Cells in the Skull. In my project, I created an imaging platform that allows us to observe how blood vessels interact with bone-forming cells during skull bone growth and healing. This insight will help us accelerate the development of better treatments for patients suffering from debilitating skull injuries. In the future, I plan to pursue a tenure-track faculty position and to start a lab focused on developing regenerative therapies for orthopedic conditions.
NCWIT appreciates the support of our sponsors, without whom recognizing these technologists would not be possible. Thank you to the NCWIT Collegiate Awards sponsors, Amazon, Qualcomm, and Palo Alto Networks. And thank you to NCWIT Lifetime Partner, Apple, for its generous support of the entire Aspirations in Computing program.
Okay, so I received word that we are having some technological difficulties. So please give me a second while I stop sharing and then reshare. Hopefully that will help us clear up. Okay, and let's see, someone will tell me if that is not sharing properly, but I'm gonna keep going. Okay. Okay, so, we would like to thank the sponsors that made this event possible. And thank you in advance for your patience, as we do currently experience technical issues. And if we experience any other bandwidth issues, thank you so much for just staying in there with us and remaining patient. I encourage you to post your questions, comments, and anything else to our question and answer board throughout this session, or to upvote any questions that you would like to have answered. We'll answer as many as possible at the end of the presentation. So now to get our conversation for change rolling, I want you to take a second to imagine being able to quantify the economic impact of racism and sexism. That's exactly what our speaker today is doing. Dr. Lisa D. Cook is currently a professor of economics and international relations at Michigan State University. Her research explores economic history, economic growth and development, and innovation. Dr. Cook's accomplishments are numerous, to understate it. I encourage you to visit ncwit.org to read her full bio. She literally is hashtag Black Girl Magic. It's insane. I'm going to pull a little bit from her bio and add a little bit to tell y'all about her. So prior to her appointment at Michigan State University, she was on the faculty of Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government. She was also the deputy director for Africa Research at the Center for International Development at Harvard University and a national fellow at Stanford University. In addition to serving on numerous boards, including the National Science Foundation, she is an Edison Fellow at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. She has published a number of articles, book chapters, and working papers. And to steal a line from her LinkedIn profile, sometimes she advises presidents, ministers of finance, and central bank governors on economic policy, just sometimes. If the sheer magnitude of her professional accomplishments has not astounded you, she also speaks 5 languages: English, French, Russian, Spanish, and Wolof. Dr. Cook, welcome. It is such an honor to have you here with us today. I am going to turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Brittany. I am so delighted to be here. Thank you so much to NCWIT for this incredible invitation and this incredible time, at this incredible time. So I am just sharing my screen here to get us started. Lost Einsteins and Gladyses. Finding and retaining missing women in innovation. And this is what I'd like to talk about today. Just to motivate it, I'd like to start with a few stylized facts. Ideas and innovation are essential to economic growth. We know this from Nobel Prize winner Paul Romer, who based his research on endogenous growth and developed ideas related to growth that governments, that countries can undertake themselves to enhance the living standards of all people in the world and all people in that particular country. This goes back to Guerillicus, 1957, where patents have been related to economic activity. So my focus is on patents. So I'd like to start with some news before some facts. We talked about this a lot when it happened. Certainly it was said by Larry Summers, and he may have been, the whole conversation started a big conversation, a larger conversation in America about women in the sciences. And economists have been those among those who are trying to answer why so few women enter scientific research. The research that I'm doing, it's typically called the Idea Gap in Pink and Black, attempts to answer not only this question, but also those related to innovation and entrepreneurship. Let me tell you a bit about this research. And this research was done in, it feels like, an antediluvian period, a period when Google patents wasn't available. So I'm going to describe the work and I'm going to describe the methods, but I'm also going to talk about policy prescriptions and how to get more women in this endeavor. Using the patent data for the economics of innovation and technical change was pioneered recently by Hall, Jaffe, and Trachtenberg, 2001, this NBER data set that had an overview of information on inventors, geographical area, owner, and technology. And there were a few other papers with this common set of co-authors that used patent data to obtain information related to innovation and technical change. So one thing that we know from the initial work that I and others did is that African Americans and women have been increasingly involved at the beginning of this process. So when I'm talking about the innovation process, I'm talking about education, sort of training in STEM, and then training as an actual inventor. So practicing in a lab, practicing the trade that one has learned in a laboratory with other people and actually patenting, for example. And then the final stage is commercialization of invention. So whatever is produced in this period of training and then practice, we should see in commercialization. And commercialization is where, say, IPOs come from, and Apple and Google and other firms come from, other tech firms come from. So it's really important. This is a really important process in the innovation economy. So what I started looking at was women and African Americans who had science and engineering PhDs, believing that they would be the contributors to all these patents that I was beginning to investigate. And 1970, women had 9%, held 9% of science and engineering PhDs. By 2005, they held 40%, and that trend continues. For African Americans, it was 1% in 1970, and it was 4% in 2005. Different orders of magnitude, of course, but still moving in the direction of significant increase from that low base. And we see similar trends for both groups and master's programs. So again, these are data that I used in my initial research. I'll tell you a bit more to update that, but this is where women were obtaining PhDs over time in S&E fields, in science and engineering and health fields. You can see that has changed a bit over time, but for life sciences has been most prominent. More than half of PhDs in biology go to women these days. And certainly for mathematics has been sort of second behind the life sciences, and engineering has always been the smallest field for women since 1968, since these data have been recorded. We're looking at African Americans. We see a somewhat similar trend in the sense that life sciences have been most dominant, but it's not the case that engineering is where they've gotten the fewest degrees. This is varied over time. Sometimes it's been the physical sciences, and sometimes it's been mathematics. So these are slightly different, but as you know, for African Americans, we have both men and women in the data set. And again, as I mentioned, this same trend is true for master's degrees. So if we're updating this between 2000 and 2011, the share of S&E bachelor's degrees going to women remained roughly flat. More than half are still going to women in biological, agricultural, and social sciences. They declined in computer science, something this audience would know a lot about, mathematics, physics, engineering, and economics. So there's some movement in the wrong direction. And the reason I mentioned bachelor's degrees, not only would they be the foundation for PhDs, but for patenting, it's going to be bachelor's degrees that are most important. The share of S&E bachelor's degrees among African Americans continues to increase slowly. So just to put a fine point on it, women continue to enroll at relatively low rates. If we talk about the current period, engineering, 23% of degrees of S&E doctorates, of doctors in engineering, sorry. Computer science is 25%, physical science is 33%, and economics 38%. And same true for doctorates, that this is increasing slowly. But that only talks about the beginning of the process. At the end of the process, they appear on the face of it less engaged at the end. This is the period where you have the development and sale of invention. And this is an issue of great interest to economists, since innovation is a source of wealth generation and higher living standards, and also of significant wealth inequality. And the papers that preceded my work in 2010, 2011, we see that women commercialized, others showed that women commercialized their inventions less than their male counterparts, and that they patented less than their counterparts. So what did I find in my earliest work? I found that women and African Americans were actually assigning their patents to firms, or commercializing their patents at rates that seemed comparable to the previous literature. So for women, I found it was about 75%, for African Americans about 50%, and for all inventors obtaining patents in the US, 82%. And just to be clear, when you assign a patent to an entity, it can be a firm, it can be a university, it can be some other entity besides yourself. So my when I say firms here, I actually mean to entities outside of the individual inventors. So what we see is a puzzle. So we see participation growing from 1968 or 1970 with these degrees in general. What we don't see is this commensurate increase in patenting. We see gender and racial differences that seem to exist and persist at the end of the process. I would say at the middle and at the end of the process. So the questions that I had were, could we improve the identification of women and African Americans? Punchline, I'll anticipate what I will say later on. Yes, we could. If we account for foreign names, does that innovation gap still exist? And what's the probability of participation in commercialization in the universe of US inventors? So these are the questions I was trying to ask. And of course, I was trying to ask about what we could learn from all these new data, including what are the determinants of commercialization? Because if we know what leads to commercialization, to entrepreneurship for women and for African-American inventors relative to the population, we could figure out possibly how to close that gap. So the punchline of this research is that about this idea gap is that it's both closing and opening. It's closed and closing on the commercialization end. We find that the quality is comparable at the final stage. We show that the idea gap is open and opening at the inventive activity stage, because we don't see women filing as much as we see others filing for patents. So we see this this gap at the very very beginning of the patenting process, but that's in the middle stage of the practice of invention. So that suggests that there's potential arbitrage related to wealth generation, where opportunities are being missed. For example, a foreign origin contribution to innovation has possibly been understated among women. And I use that to try to identify more research. So let me just quickly go through the rest of the talk. This is now, let's say, innovative history, if you're talking about studies that were done in 1995. But I'm just giving you the groundwork for how we are identifying women better and what else we can do to identify women in patent data. Now, why do women need to be identified? Because patent data do not tell you what the gender of a patentee is, do not tell you what the race of an inventor is. There's no demographic data in patent records. So you have to be careful and comprehensive in trying to identify women and minorities in these data, or racial and ethnic groups in these data. So one thing that I found in an early NSF study was that to identify women, and this became a common way to identify women, it still is, in PAT data, you use the first named inventor to see if that were a woman. And this is a very crude measure, because you would call a woman's patent one that has a woman on it, and that happens to be the first name inventor. And of course, they use in this 1995 study U.S. address. Most importantly, they used common American names, largely English names. And one thing that I know from my other research and from having written my dissertation in Russia is that most people who are doing PhDs in the U.S. at U.S. institutions have a degree from a foreign university and a first degree from a foreign university, and that has been increasing over time. So what I decided to do, and I was one of the first ones to do this, is to use commercial software to capture foreign origin women's names. For example, Asian names, Slavic names, and the common English names that were found in that data set were Mary, Patricia, Linda, Jennifer, for example, and then some of the common Indian, Chinese, Slavic names that you would see in the patent data were Rohini, Seema, Uma, Lin, Xiao, Sue, Tatiana, Irina, Svetlana, and Galina. So obviously we were missing a lot. I won't go into too many details, but I sought to improve on what NSF had done in terms of identifying women patentees. I tried to improve on the samples, got larger samples, tried to improve on this crude measure. I used discounting, which is now common, by attributing to a woman the fraction of a patent she represents. For example, if there are five people on a patent team, if there's one woman, one-fifth of the patent is attributed to that woman. This is all in an attempt to measure how women are participating on patent teams and whether they are participating on patent teams. And I'll just say a bit about African-American inventors as well. For previous data, there really wasn't any. Most studies have been of, if we're focusing on race and ethnicity, they had been of Chinese and Indian inventors and mainly focused on Silicon Valley. Certainly they've been, there have been case studies, for example, historical great inventors that Raymond Fouché wrote about. There have been collections of biographies. For example, Patricia Slooby has several of these. And we were writing, it was really funny, we were writing at the same time in 2004. She had been working on this book and I was putting together a patent data set. So it was really interesting that we were working at the same time. So for African Americans, the challenge was slightly different, and I was trying to match them to Black names. I started searching on Black names to identify people in the African-Americans in the PAT data set, but this was not as fruitful as I thought it would be because those are the Black names that we see in the literature, say the literature that was popular in the mid-2000s. These were post-civil rights era names. So you would need to be born in the 1960s and the 1970s, especially in the 1970s, to have one of those names, to start having one of those names. But many of the inventors in the data set I was looking at, say from 1970 forward, they were fully grown adults by that period. So matching isn't so easy. So had to use a number of other methods like biographies. I had to go to obituaries. There's a lot that I had to do to try to identify more African-American patentees by creating the universe of potential patentees. And I'll just tell you what I finally came up with. Between 1963 and 2006, 1,861 patents, 425 inventors. Today, we use many more methods like artificial intelligence, like machine learning, to try to identify women and African Americans. But there is a big caveat there. I just mentioned problems associated with matching, or not problems, but the way names that are not standardly American or English sounding names, may be assigned to more than one gender. So you have to be very careful about those, for example. And with respect to African Americans, often these data are trained on census data, and there are well-known problems associated with African Americans being under-identified in census data. So if you are training the data on census data sets, of course, those problems are magnified when you use machine learning, when you use AI. So you have to be super careful about these methods today. So again, I was using something that was a lot cruder than the methods we have today. I was using commercial software for African Americans. This also took advantage of increasing residential segregation. And this is what I wound up with from the new matching process. Over 4,000, close to 5,000 patents, over 1,600 inventors. And these post-civil rights era Black names are more present than in the historical data sets that I've used. And this is something that the software exploits. So when the data merged, there are over 6,500 patents, over 2,000 inventors, and 305 African-American women inventors. And that's important for what I'll be talking about later. But one thing that I want to emphasize again is that this is the first time that African Americans had been identified when I started doing this research in the patent data systematically. When I started doing this research in the early 2000s, I was counseled by senior women in economics not to do any research that focused on women, not to do any research that focused on African Americans, because I would never get tenure. I was told that journal editors were not interested in women, or research on women. They were not interested in research on African Americans, and I would never get tenure. This is what I was canceled. So I am glad that I, in that instance, that I'm hard-headed. I am not always glad that I am hard-headed or determined, a more charitable interpretation of that. But I am glad to see much more of this research being done. I am glad that many others are proving them wrong. So what do we learn from the data that I collected using these methods? So before the previous research, we found that it was 9% lower with respect to commercialization for women. After using these new methods, I found that it was only 4% lower. So that's what I mean by the commercialization gap or assignment to firms closing. For African Americans, it was 59% before I applied these methods, and after applying these methods, it was 69%, which is the same for women. So one thing that I want to stress is that even though it seems as though this is a good thing, I also measured this against historical data. And one thing that I found was that the peak year, still the peak year, even using 2010 data as this research uses, even then, the peak for African-American per capita invention is still 1899, even when using 2010 data. There's a lot that I talk about in my 2014 paper that will elucidate that, but it's still much lower than it was in the past and much lower than the African-American population. So it's something to worry about. I looked at particular firms that are publicly traded. And what I found was that there was 50% assignment in the period 1976 to 1980 and 47% assignment in the period 1990 to 2000. For women, it was only 6% lower. And by 1990 to 2000, it was 7% higher, or 54%. So this is in the largest firms. the publicly traded firms and the highest valued, well, actually, that's not necessarily true, not necessarily the highest valued firms, but let's say the publicly traded firms. Those are the largest, some of the largest firms. For African Americans in the period 1976 to 1980, they were lower, and in 4% lower, and in 1990 to 2000, they were 7% higher, 54%, which is comparable to women. So at the most valuable, some of the most valuable firms, publicly traded firms, African Americans and women were having greater success, or are having greater success. It's somewhat of an anomaly. But I'll tell you one more thing that I found that is one of the most durable findings of my research, is that single-sex patent teams are worse at invention than mixed-gender teams. So single-sex male, single-sex female teams are worse than mixed-gender patent teams. And I found that striking because as a person who attended a women's college, of course I thought that the patent teams that were all women were going to be the most productive teams. I am open to learning something all the time. So that suggests to me that these mixed gender teams make this case for diversity, that diversity, when it is executed along many different dimensions, is good for innovation. And these are the ones who commercialize their inventions more than the other two groups. So if CEOs, if chief innovation officers are not seeking to make sure that patent teams are integrated along many dimensions, such as gender, such as race, such as ethnicity, then they're leaving money on the table. And I'll say more about that in just a moment. So again, this is one of the most interesting findings that has been empirically supported by economists and subsequently in other fields. One more finding that I'll just mention is in terms of quality. There's increasing quality among women and African-American inventors in the US patent data. Median forward citations, the number of patent citing and inventors patent, are competitive with, are higher than those for all and US patentees in all categories. Of course, citation rates vary by technological categories, but this is true for all categories, that the quality of patents is rising. But there's still less patent activity for US patents. This is 235 patents per million for the US population. For women, it's 40 patents per million. And for African Americans, it's 6 patents per million, or one order of magnitude less for women relative to all US inventors, and then 6 patents per million, or one order of magnitude lower than for women for African Americans. So if we're looking at women and women inventors using counts of inventors or using multiple inventors, we see whether you use one measure or the other, you see this increasing. For African Americans, and you should use the left scale to measure them. This is what it is, just doing the count. And then for US inventors, this is the right-hand scale. So you see greater participation by women. It's hard to see for African Americans. And for all inventors look more like US inventors. And just to be clear, the share of US inventors is falling in the U.S. patent data. These are residents of the U.S. The residents, the share of residents of other countries is increasing over that period. And this shows the shift in technological categories that women are patenting in. Remember that I said that drugs and medicine would be where we would expect to find women because of their degrees in biology, the PhDs in biology. But we don't see this. We see it rising over time, but it seems like it should have been there from the very beginning. But we see them participating on chemical patents, and we see them participating the least on computer and communications patents in some decades, but that's not consistent across across time. Electronic or electrical patents would also be where they're participating less. And for African Americans, again, this has changed over time. Similar pattern to women in the sense that they participated on chemical patents more than any others over time. But what we see here is rising participation by African Americans on computer and communications patents. So in terms of the questions I would like to answer and that I would like to continue to answer, what are the determinants or correlates of patent and commercialization activity among women and African-American inventors? What explains gender and racial gaps, relatively higher commercialization activity and relatively lower patent activity? This conundrum that we just saw. And why is this important? Why is identifying missing women important? Because this has implications for income, wealth, and GDP at each stage. Again, education, training, and commercialization. So we see inequality at each stage, whether we're talking about participation in STEM fields or we're talking about participation in the practice of invention. This has implications for economic growth. What my co-author Yan-Yan Yang and I found was that GDP per capita could be 4.4% higher. If women and African-Americans participated, more women and African-Americans participated in the innovation economy. So what about policy prescriptions? We're leaving money on the table. If more women and let's talk about just women for the moment, more women participated, we would all see higher living standards. There is a macroeconomic implication of not having more women. So there are some things we could do that I've written about recently. On the supply side or the pipeline side, we could implement more mentoring programs. We have more research that shows that exposure to inventors improves life outcomes, including the probability that one will become an inventor. We could also count better. At the USPTO, they are counting more women. The Success Act that is based on my 2011 paper and the IDEA Act, so that was passed in 2019, and the IDEA Act that is making its way through Congress now are both based on my paper, and I am grateful that they are, but what they're trying to do is to count who's participating in innovation better. There can also be a lot more on the demand side with respect to the climate in which people working in the innovation economy are working. This working environment can be improved for women, for example, providing better childcare options. There's a big debate about that right now, about the care economy. Sexual harassment and sexual assault can be minimized. Certainly, racism and sexism are some of the biggest threats to the free flow of ideas, and they should be minimized at every juncture. And those who are leading innovation activities should make sure that those are minimized and addressed. What we have seen recently, more than in the past, is more strikes at tech firms, for example, and we see unions being formed at tech firms, and they're not arguing for better salary. What they're arguing for is better working conditions, including, for example, working against forced mediation when there's a sexual harassment claim. So I think these working conditions could help augment not just participation by women and African Americans, but could augment living standards, could increase our innovative capacity. So let's talk about the missing lattices. So why am I calling this the missing lattices? Well, first of all, NCWIT is honoring Dr. Gladys West with the NCWIT Pioneer in Tech Award. And I am just thrilled to see this. Pioneering women in innovation are not always missing. Sometimes they are sitting in plain sight and they are not celebrated like other inventors. So I am just delighted that NCWIT is focusing on Dr. Gladys West and giving her her flowers, giving her her due, and awarding her this award based on her research, her pioneering research on GPS technology. We know it wasn't easy, and we are so grateful. I am so grateful during Black History Month to be able to talk about Dr. Gladys West and not just George Washington Carver and Madam C.J. Walker. So thank you so much for that. There are inventors who are living and living role models for all of us. Again, thank you, NCWIT, for reducing the number of women who are missing in innovation. And I would encourage all of us to reduce this number and not only identify them, but celebrate them as well. Thank you so much for your attention, and I look forward to your questions.
I'm muted. Thank you so much, Dr. Cook. That was so good. We do have some questions. I want to start with, what would be your first action item on a solution plan to engage the underrepresented in the process of commercialization of innovation?
I know I was being very facetious at the end about Black History Month and about Women's History Month. Just, you know, a lot of dead people are trotted out as if innovation was great in the past. What I'd like to see is living inventors, living people who contribute to innovation trotted out during that period. And I also would like to see more visits to Spark Lab, for example, at the Smithsonian, at the Lemelson Center for the Study of Invention and Innovation in Washington. This is for children, but there's a lot that you can learn about the process of innovation. They walk in and they don't have an invention. When they walk out, they have an invention. And what does that do to children? It gives them a sense, or anybody, it would do it to anybody, gives them a sense that their ideas are valuable, that their curiosity is valued, and that anyone can contribute to invention and innovation. And I think that is at the top of my list. Now that we know that exposure to inventors can augment the probability of a child becoming an inventor, we should exploit that to the maximum. And we should put people who are living examples like Dr. Gladys West in front of people, in front of children, in front of those who are practicing invention and innovation as much as we can.
Yes, we are so excited to give Dr. Gladys West her roses today. She definitely more than deserves them. You actually kind of led into the next question that we had for you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you an idea, kind of a concept, and I want to hear your reaction to it, okay? Mm-hmm. So if we want more women and African Americans or Black people to invent more, should we start marketing to or encouraging those groups to invent at an even earlier your age, perhaps as early as middle school? And if so, how might we do that more effectively?
I think that's a good question. And as you said, I sort of led into it by advertising Spark Lab, as I always do. There should be a Spark Lab everywhere. And I know that they aren't just in Washington, D.C. There are different ones around the country. But that should be brought, it should be mobile, and it should be brought into the classroom. And rather than, you know, Black children especially are penalized sometimes for just being themselves. They're penalized earlier and earlier, let's say, by police officers in schools. Black women are disciplined more than Black girls are disciplined more than all their other counterparts, and that's increasing. That is the antithesis of what we want to see. If we want to augment curiosity, there was a child who built a clock, and I can't think of some of where exactly it was in Texas, but it was in Texas, and he brought it to school, and he was arrested. He was dragged out of school. Homeboy just wanted to be on time. He just wanted to figure out an interesting way to tell time. And we have to identify and augment curiosity in many different places and encourage people, because ideas can come from any quarter. Nobody has a patent on where ideas can come from. They don't just come from white men. They come from many different types of people and from many different types of things. So I think that's the first thing that I would like to do, is to reshape the way we think about who can contribute to the intellectual capacity, the innovative capacity of a country and to our country.
Thank you. So this next question comes from someone who is a member of NSBE, and she's heard from their intellectual property special interest group that African Americans don't file patents on their own because it isn't even thought of, even at the PhD level, right? Do you think that colleges and universities will move to promoting intellectual property in the future? Is that a wise move? How do you feel about that?
I think they will, and we've seen that growing over time. There are more colleges and universities that have tech transfer offices, for example. So I really believe that that will increase. There's just a lot of heterogeneity across universities. I mean, you know, Stanford has been doing this a long time, and a lot of companies have grown up through Stanford University, including Google, for example. So where Larry Page and Sergey Brin were graduate students. So I think that this is happening, but I would say that more of it needs to happen. For example, in the private sector, Bell Labs used to be the model of mentoring for graduate students, for women and underrepresented minorities. And there, people learned, like Lonnie Johnson learned at NASA government labs in these internships, how to file a patent. And I think it is something that is critical. You can learn how to do that a little bit at Spark Lab, or you can learn that you should do it at Spark Lab. But I think this is something that is underrated. So I thank the NSBE member for bringing that up.
Yes, thank you. Okay, so next question. Can you explain a little bit more about why commercialization is the most important indicator of participation?
I wasn't saying that it was the most important indicator. It is the one that I use in research because it is easily discoverable on patent records, right? It is the one, in my view, that is most important when you're thinking about wealth inequality, because that is where IPOs come into existence. And what we know about the top seven firms in the United States, and what we know about the top seven billionaires in the world is that they are associated in some way with a tech firm that at some point was an idea that was protected by intellectual property that got commercialized. So that's why I'm saying that this is extremely important for wealth inequality. And so I've told you why it's extremely important for wealth, for the valuation of firms. But let me give you one more statistic that will bridge that gap. 5% of founders receiving venture funding are women. 1% are African Americans. 0.2% are Black women. So if we're talking about, I know this is one proxy, this is crude. Most firms don't receive venture capital, but I'm just talking about the ones that do. That summarizes the kind of access and the kind of participation that that we see with respect to women and with respect to African Americans. Something has got to change. If we're saying that mixed gender teams are the most productive, that we can get greater GDP with the participation of more women and more African Americans, we've got to do something differently. That's how you get more women and African Americans in the innovation economy. And there seems to be a bottleneck.
Yeah. Okay, let's squeeze in one more question.
Sure.
Okay. What role, if any, do you feel violence may still play in the disproportionately low number of patent filings from Black people and other minoritized identities? And maybe not violence, like physical violence, but even violence as a concept or a construct.
Right, sure, sure. Well, you know, in the period that I have studied the most, in the period 1870 to 1940, it gave African Americans a sense of a fear, and they stopped patenting as a result of that kind of violence. So if you see it, I remember one of the reviewers in a journal, or several reviewers actually, at several economics journals asked me why an African-American in one state would be concerned about the lynching of an African-American in another state. Well, we see post-George Floyd, I mean, we didn't have to wait for that. Many of us knew before that. There's a sense of fear. There is a constant sense of fear. And what I am saying is that this is the antithesis. You've got to have an open society where people don't live in fear of being stopped by the police, for example, during routine operations, during a routine traffic stop or routine activities, even in the classroom. Again, women and Black women and Black boys are being disciplined much more than other groups, and they're losing out on this augmentation of curiosity. That's where it happens. And if you're dragging them out of the classroom, you're going to minimize the kind of curiosity they're going to have. It's not safe to be curious, not safe for them to be there. So I think this is something that is ongoing and that has to be addressed systematically.
Wow, thank you so much. That was amazing. I think that we are going to wrap it up. Dr. Cook, like, it's been such a pleasure kind of having this conversation with you. I think that economics is probably a subject that I understand like the least, but the economics of racism and sexism sounds just so like, I want to know more about this. So I was really excited to kind of learn more about you and the work that you've done and all of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for having me. And congratulations again, Dr. West.